Love to.
Walter R. Yetnikov.
John Bon Jovi, I'm...
I was president.
I'm president.
Chairman.
I'm the chairman of CBS Records.
Or in excess.
Hi, I'm Bill Clinton. I'm president of the United States.
My job is...
songwriter.
I sing.
Piano player. I play guitar.
We'd all like to know what I'm supposed to be doing.
MC Fusion, Credit to the Nation.
Former manager of Led Zeppelin.
I manage the group Dire Straits.
Security chief for Metallica.
Promotions department.
I'm a magician.
And I want your vote.
Every year, the music industry pats itself on the back with a round of awards ceremonies. High-profile events where industry luminaries, pop starlets, legendary crooners, cult heroes, chart toppers, soul divas, and posses of the new rap masters,
it's Snoop Doggy Dogg,
are hunted down by film crews and fans alike. It's the usual media scrum, all screams, snatch shots, and sound bites.
There's many people making music, how are you? So that's good.
Good to see you again.
Hi, it's
Snoop. You can't call me, I've got to go in. I have 2 minutes left. Where, do you have to call me, where the fuck is he?
I'm not nervous, I'm calm, I'm cool.
Denver, it's Queen Latifah.
I cannot get through this phone.
I mean, I've been to probably 10 Grammys now. I've never won a Grammy.
I've really got to go in now.
Stars bestow their favors on their chosen media, while the cops eject the unwanted.
Did you say he could stay here without a fresh pass?
No.
Okay, let's go.
It all adds to the sense of hysteria, ensuring maximum coverage for this $35 billion section of the global entertainment industry.
Good evening and welcome to London's Alexandra Palace. Tonight we celebrate the very best of British music.
Or some argue the best selling.
The Brit Awards, 94.
In an industry where sales are everything, awards in general are in recognition of retail achievements. Market penetration precedes prize giving, which is then fed back to a carefully screened media pool.
Have we get past, please? Thank you very much.
From a somewhat hot, cramped room, the press room, a global marketing opportunity unfolds.
Okay, just hold on to that. All the crews, LNN, London News Network, MTV.
A meticulous public relations strategy keeps the troops well away from the actual proceedings until the moment the awards ceremony is to be disseminated by print, tape, TV, radio,
not actually covering the event,
fax and phone, to an audience of hundreds of millions of potential record buyers. Each reporter is to convey to his or her listeners, readers or viewers, the glamour of the event, their privileged insight into a glitzy night out, an intimate brush with fame.
No one told us that it was going to be a press conference. We can't use a press conference.
The press conference is the media equivalent of the Battery Farm, and there's a PR pecking order.
Hello.
If you want extra morsels, you'll have to be in favour.
I loved it. Welcome.
A post-awards party pass? Speak nicely to the right person.
You get me in a corner and I'll sort you out.
Should I
have to come to me.
The show is about to start in about the next 10 minutes. The warm-up act is just going to start warming the audience through. We're going to run the press room much like we did last year.
I.e. seasoned pros won't be holding their breath, waiting for a glimpse of a star.
It's Elton John!
With a hit record every year for the past quarter of a century, Elton John greets the occasion with aplomb.
Thank you very much. Good evening, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be here at the Alexandra Palace for this, the Brit Awards of 1994, which is the most prestigious evening in the music business calendar.
The glitz on stage and the hard media graft backstage, though carefully segregated, are two sides to the same coin.
Everyone at Virgin knows.
Well, clearly not. Gabrielle.
There's barely time to savor a moment of personal triumph before getting back to the real work of awards ceremonies, facing the mass media who've seen it all before.
Oh my
my God, what can I say?
When they have finished everything they've got to do on the stage, then each act will come in here for a grilling. Ah!
Which, as new stars soon discover, takes practice.
Hello, gorgeous!
What's the secret?
There's more to microphone skills than laying down vocal tracks in the studio.
Okay, would anyone like to ask any questions? I have a radio mic.
And with steady cams flying around your head, a credible media persona is essential.
Gabrielle, what does it feel like to be the best newcomer?
You could try being speechless.
I'm still buzzing at the moment, so I'm not going to make much sense, I'm afraid. Brilliant.
Dina Carroll!
You could try poise.
It's nice to get this much recognition, yeah.
York!
Or humility.
It rhymes with cheer.
With a touch of irony.
Okay, thanks very much.
Right, now, Rue, are you vegetarian?
No, baby, I am a meat eater.
And me. A meat eater. Very good. Don't tell Linda McCartney. Anyway, because our next guest recorded the biggest selling single and album of 1993. He's larger than life and he'd do anything for love. He's the mighty Meat Loaf!
Now, you're looking at me, but I have absolutely no idea what I look like.
Well, you don't want to know.
I mean, I don't want to know. I'm making a pop video. I'm supposed to look great. He's like the, you know, the king of makeup. Don't I look really good? Oh, you've got questions for this?
Yeah, we just had a couple.
I thought we were just going to talk.
Hey, you all right, Timmy?
I got it, man.
Okay. Tim's all right. He's all right. He's all right.
Okay, you guys ready?
It's just questions, huh?
Yep. Just people are calling this a comeback. Do you consider this a comeback?
No, I never went anywhere. That's like I never could figure out when they call Tina Turner a comeback. I mean, I didn't go anywhere, they did.
In fact, Meat Loaf did go somewhere, to court to file for bankruptcy. Protracted legal wrangles over royalties, artistic differences, vocal paralysis, drink and depression took their toll on the man some called the biggest, fattest, loudest in rock and roll. When in 89 he again went knocking on record company doors, to many, Meat Loaf seemed past his sell-by date.
He was really not in any position, at least by most other record companies, to be asking for a deal of any sort.
At that stage, there was not a lot of interest.
In our business, the idea of an over 40s, overweight, you know, rocker sex symbol doesn't compute.
What did compute was a 20 million strong fan base for Meat Loaf's original Bat Out of Hell, now 16 years old.
Listen!
And their potential loyalty to new product.
Meat Loaf! Your favorite, a Bat Out of Hell!
He was still in great voice. He was still one of a kind. And his original Bat Out of Hell album was still selling anywhere from 500,000 to 1 million units a year on a worldwide basis. I thought it was an awfully good bet.
Will you do your Meat Loaf for me?
Meat Loaf was signed to Virgin in 1989.
I signed Meat Loaf in 1989.
Slightly confusing. How is the Meat Loaf sliced exactly?
MCA have Meat Loaf signed for America, and we have the rest of the world.
I'll tell you the real story on this.
Okay.
The Virgin people over here were real excited about having me for the world and everything. And so that's where I wanted to go. I wanted to be on the entire world, Virgin. Except for the West Coast company, their exact words, the guy's no longer there, but their exact words, Meat Loaf, nah, he's not hip enough.
Oh, come on. Do your Meat Loaf for me, huh?
So they decided they didn't want me.
So an artist can be picked over by the various record companies of the world, carved up into territories on the judgment, some say the whim, of local record company heads.
The MCA guy here, I'll tell you exactly what he said. Oh, yeah, in England, he might do 75,000 units or 100,000 units. That guy don't work for MCA anymore.
Half the knack in marketing records is to sign the right band at the right time and then release the right product. Having taken the plunge at the corporate level, the troops must be brought on board.
What do we call him?
Mr. Loaf.
Mr. Loaf.
Mr. Loaf.
To you, Jeremy.
Well, unfortunately, most of you around this table haven't had the honour of meeting him yet, but...
How does he look these days?
Lost weight.
In the biggest Virgin campaign of 93, 140 staff will be deployed on a year-long global campaign. But both Virgin and MCA's extensive TV, radio, press, video, and product management departments depend on one thing.
The strategy for the album was really quite simple. First and foremost, make a great record. Make a record that when you listen to it, people will go, wow, that is one great record.
Enter Jim Steinman, the so-called Wagner of rock and roll, author of Meatloaf's fabled Bat Out of Hell. During the years of estrangement from the Pavarotti of pop, both their careers had floundered. They needed each other. Happily, the chemistry was still there.
The minute we started working, it felt like a week.
Taking up where they left off, way over the top.
Every song I write with a theatrical or cinematic context in mind. I've never written a song where I don't visualize a character singing it. That's just the way I work. I couldn't write any other way. So in my mind, it's always on a stage or in a film.
Such grandiose vision calls for extravagant interpretation.
I'm very theatrical. I think I'm an actor more than I think I'm a musician.
The muse was ready, but the maestro was not quite.
Jim says, I need a little bit more time. And I said, okay, so I decided I'd go out on the road for 6 weeks. I did 500 shows.
There's a man in the shadows with a gum in his eye and a blade shining no so bright.
And so we stayed out on the road for 89 and 90 and some of 91.
There's evil in the air and there's thunder in the sky and a killer's on the bloodshot streets.
And we didn't get into the studio until May of 91. And
the record went vastly over budget. And there were several times that I had to simply throw more chips onto the table.
I had numerous conversations with the management office in LA who would needed a little bit more money for this week or that week. And yes, we'll promise it'll definitely come through. You're going to get it.
Of course, the way we work, it takes a long time once you get in there.
This record ended up costing us in seven figures.
We didn't know whether it would ever hit the streets.
It was getting a bit troublesome on that perspective.
Seems like it took about 15 minutes.
You know, like everything else, it's the risk business.
I just reassured myself.
We felt we had a really good record coming.
Well, we're going to need it because, literally we have a mountain to climb here. In terms of his profile, in terms of the gigs and everything else is fine, but that's to, if you like, an audience that is already on his side. We've got to get that mass audience out there. They've forgotten about Meatloaf.
The marketing research approach was as if for any relaunched meat product.
Which showed that his name, even though he hadn't enjoyed a huge run of popular success in recent years, was still known by a very wide demographic.
But would the demographics dig into their pockets after so long?
People who bought that originally had got quite a bit older, and they weren't spending a lot of their time in record shops.
But I think with Meatloaf, the key thing was knowing that we had two major things to work off.
You had Meatloaf himself, the image of Meatloaf himself.
One was the Meatloaf name, which has been branded to people.
Who was this big character?
The other was actually having the title that, you know, over 2 million people in the UK had bought of an album called Bat Out of Hell.
25 million people bought Bat Out of Hell.
This is maybe more.
And the inspired name for the sequel?
Simply naming it Bat Out of Hell 2 at a stroke gave us two strands to the campaign, Meatloaf and Bat Out of Hell.
I didn't call it Bat Out of Hell 2 just to identify with the first record. It really does feel like an extension.
You know, when Bat Out of Hell 2 comes out, it's like, yeah, do you remember how you felt when Bat Out of Hell 1 came out? Do you remember what you were doing? Weren't those good times?
Is there going to be a big difference between Bat Out of Hell 1 and Bat Out of Hell 2?
Is there a big difference? Well, it has a different cover.
Well, how different exactly? Comparisons with the CBS release of 1980 show remarkable similarities. The heavy metal clichés, reckless speed, death skulls, improbably masculine physiques, blood-sucking bats, are all present in the Bat Out of Hell 2 graphic package.
It was fantasy, it was mythological, it was to do with rock and roll. Most importantly, it had a bike on it. But at the same time, it's also about, dragons, and it's about huge bats, and it's about Wagner.
But fundamentally, it's about brand loyalty. Even the gothic typography is lifted directly from the best-selling 16-year-old meat product. And the bat, babe, and bike iconography translated richly, expensively, to the next marketing tool.
The video. The video.
The video was quite expensive as well.
We put our hands in our pockets and mortgaged, you know, our houses, our children, everything else to make that video.
Super wide out of for you now.
Okay, we're walking in.
Yeah.
I'm walking. Tell them I'm walking. This is a very romantic song.
I'm walking.
One of the most romantic stories there is Beauty and the Beast.
So what do you think? Do I look like a beast?
Yeah, cool.
it was a gamble, because Meat Loaf's history, actually, although he was known as a very theatrical artist, wonderful stage shows, he'd never really made a concept video that was that spectacular.
Oh, it's great, it's totally great.
But we felt we should actually invest in a great visual story. Try and use the best director around.
Michael Bay, known for his Pepsi commercials.
And come up with a video concept that sort of was for the world.
So in the finest Hollywood tradition, music, myth, movies, and money meet in one of the most expensive videos ever made.
This is just a long shot.
It's really easy to do.
You're blind dates here. Let's go. Come on, the movies, okay?
Yeah,
babe. Thanks.
Hi, Dana, I'm Meat. How you doing?
Now, Milo, let me just tell you where we are.
All right, shoot.
You've, like, come through the woods, all right?
Come through the woods.
And you've come upon her. We've already shot her shots of her and her. You've seen your POV, all right? And this is the point where I'm just shooting over her shoulder. We're going to give you a glint of a mirror, all right? And you're just going to catch the sun, and it's going to reflect into her mirror, hit her face, and that's when she turns and looks at you. This is like a two-shot.
Okay.
You know, you're real far back, okay?
Okay, yeah.
Art department?
Yes, sir.
Can you just hang a couple of those dead branches down low under by him so he's not so blatantly there, okay?
Yes.
That's good. So Meatloaf. Meat?
Yeah.
You know, I asked him, what do I call you, man? I mean, Meatloaf. I was like, and he goes, well, I call you Mike, man. Call me Meat for short. Ready, guys? And ready, Meatloaf? Music. In action! Come on, Meat. In the mirror. Get it? Beauty and the Beast?
That was the basic concept of Beauty and the Beast. Like Cocteau, but not Cocteau. Not that beast, but that kind of thing. And then I saw Dracula. And so then I thought, wow, I like the way that looks, and that story was very romantic.
Subtle It Ain't, a universal love story being played out to an over-the-top soundtrack of endless hooks and crescendos in a misty gothic ambience, illusion and fantasy. Every trick of the filmmaker's artifice will be thrown at this video.
Give me like a 35.
In the age of rap, techno, pop and grunge, I Would Do Anything for Love is a relatively unfashionable sentiment. The song itself, a throwback. The promo strives for the timeless, the universal.
Cut. Good. All right, now one more time.
That's the brief, lavish imagery on the eye and ear, and revive those long forgotten and, it's hoped, unstoppable desires to consume in millions of the record buying public. Of course, the artist being an artist has more artistic ambitions.
I don't make videos in the same way that other artists make videos. I'm not using it to sell soup. I'm just trying to make a nice little cinematic statement.
This must be why the former car park attendant and jobbing actor is dubbed the Orson Welles of rock and roll.
Get up on the ledge.
As long as the stars are burning.
Man, I have absolutely no idea how this could cut.
I'll catch you here.
And I come back here.
Yes.
I have no idea what goes to what. Come through here?
Yeah.
Now, where are you going to be? He does.
And I'm going to be right here and just going to exit out here.
He knows exactly what he wants to see, right or wrong, and he got real excited about it.
And then what's going to happen is when the cops walk in,
The
couch is going to slam down to the floor.
And it comes a point where you let them go. Where you say, okay, go ahead.
Your candles blow out. You're going to turn the camera with the teeth and all teeth.
But let no one forget who holds the balance of power here, the star. The star in whom the record company has invested millions, but who alone must publicly face the critical flack of failure.
Then if they're wrong, they shoot them later.
All right, let's see if camera position.
I'll just wait to see the cut. If I don't like it, I'll say, I don't like that. What else you got?
Forbesy, let the little clip of the video run, s'il vous plaît.
In London, an anxious marketing team is granted a taste, a draft cut of a few minutes of the promo.
But I'll never like the first cut.
Uh-oh.
Perhaps it's too early to tell. Meanwhile, in L.A., the shoot goes on.
Roll camera.
And on.
Action me. Karina.
I want to do some MTV teaser advertising.
Play that.
Rolling. Germany and Scandinavia. As far as I'm concerned, I've really got to get those markets and get Australia.
Play that.
We have to see if Dana can lip sync. Do you think she can?
There's more to worry about than lip sync. As the video goes into serious overspend in LA, UK marketing's on overtime with their own synchronization problems.
Those are like important markets for me to get before we start going to Spain and France and Japan and doing all those other ones.
The logistical nightmares of a simultaneous global release.
So where can you do it? You can't do that.
Yeah. From Japan to Jaipur, from Finland to the Philippines.
The edit, well, it's pretty much set on a worldwide basis, we think. The album's for the 23rd of August.
Well, make that September. With release at last imminent, a year-long press strategy is put to the test, and they faced problems. Virgin's research into Meat's press image was decidedly unflattering. To the heavy metal mags, he was too light. To the music monthlies, he lacked musical credibility. And to the consumer press, he was a mere novelty past his sell-by date. The formidable task was to re-stimulate a taste for Meat. Step one, write a grandiose biog with Meat's own medieval flourishes that the press will gobble up.
To quote Meat Loaf, it sits in no one time frame. That if you played Bat Out of Hell to Henry VIII while he was writing Greensleeves, he would have understood the emotions, and that, you know, the serfs toiling in the fields in the Middle Ages would have understood the emotions of Bat Out of Hell, and that even, you know, when a cave woman hit her caveman over the head with the stone cudgel, she would have understood the emotions of Bat Out of Hell. You know, I think when he explained it to me like that, that was when I truly realised the magnitude of what it was we were dealing with. It's the one occasion when I suppose I felt proud to have produced a biog with an artist that did end up in Seed's Corner.
But the irony is never far from the surface.
I don't understand about this beast is here in Beverly Hills where he can get some plastic surgery.
This is true, and he's got enough money.
Right in Beverly Hills.
But do we know he's in Beverly
Hills?
But do we know he's in Beverly Hills?
Powder and mint on the fetter to catch on.
I don't think we know he's in Beverly Hills.
Well, he's got a BMW accent.
No, he's riding a Harley. This is the 50s.
But this is the 90s, and there's still a danger the whole thing will seem dated in the current market.
They don't have as many plastic surgeons in the 50s, right?
So, 4 years after being signed, and 16 years on from Bat One, it's On Your Bike Meat for the UK leg of a grueling promotional schedule, including the first ever playthrough for a carefully selected industry audience. And Virgin sought high and low for a location true to the product's schlock horror ambience.
It's a great venue. It's actually bordered by the river. It's an old pirate's castle. It's a bit of a folly, I think.
Actually, a youth club on a canal in northwest London.
To make it look as if it's something from the video.
But appropriate to what many still perceive as a novelty act. Still, teaser pieces emerge, Meat's profile rises, radio play is promised, deals are struck, and there's a pre-release coup.
Top of the Pops is just about in the bag.
MCA America, equally in the hole, desperately pushes the sequel concept.
We had our people running around with cassettes, playing it privately for important record dealers, radio stations, tip sheets, all the mechanisms in the industry that you want on your side, so that everyone was persuaded that Meat Loaf in 1993 was a very viable proposition.
16 years ago,
the 70s, one of the biggest LPs was Bat Out of Hell by Meat Loaf.
Our next guest
made an album called Bat Out of Hell.
Guess what? Just a few years later, he's made a follow-up.
What we're doing is going for a satellite, August the 25th, and as you know, it's all live available.
Mm-hmm.
Should be great.
Strap down your TV, we cross live to LA for 5 minutes of pure rock and roll craziness. Check this out.
And now, Top of the Pops, the UK's premier showcase, happily accommodates the first ever public airing at a price.
I don't know how much the satellite cost. It was, again, in the thousands.
Everything seems to cost thousands. If the accountants were to be so mercenary as to tot it all up, which they no doubt have, the act, the studio, the video, the satellite link, the travel, the bill is running to millions. The marketing team is anxious. Boards of directors, chairmen, parent companies, shareholders all expect a return on investment. When the overlength, overcost, over-the-top video finally arrives finished, UK MD Paul Conroy, himself not long in the job, knows the promo must be more than an indulgent fantasy. It must be an effective global marketing tool.
God.
That's fantastic.
I was like, it's done it.
Video, no.
It's, you know, we've got just the tool we need.
See, the video was not meant to sell anything.
And there was a lot of yo-ing and hand-slapping going on after that.
I don't know if they know that, but...
But we did have a few nervous moments. Chart Show turned it down, I think, here. I mean, we were always unsure with Meat Loaf whether he would actually appeal to MTV's playlist.
But the video's kitsch, mythic cocktail of ghoul meets girl suited MTV's ecumenical brief to speak across national, cultural and religious boundaries to its worldwide video congregation. The word drug neatly substituted. Sex and drums and rock and roll. Radio and TV were converted. The mission now to tempt an agnostic press.
We did shy away from it very, you know, I personally was very reticent about Meat Loaf coming anywhere near Kerrang.
The press and the PR machines, both sides hate each other, have a certain amount of hate for each other, and consider themselves superior to the other side.
They did call us and say, we feel Kerrang is the front line as far as Meat Loaf's marketing campaign is concerned. And we did call them back and say, we think you're mistaken.
Meat Loaf and credibility, the two ideas don't exist in the same universe.
Initially with Meat Loaf, we left them alone.
You know, there was an early review that referred to this as not so much a bat, but as a great big squawking turkey from hell.
But they need each other. They're in bed together. And to a certain degree, the press is led by clever PRs.
Virgin's press department efforts led to four exclusives. One, specialist magazine Metal Hammer, was flown to New York for a sneak album preview.
I think the metal audience is, for a start, it's the world's biggest rock audience, and there's a kind of international language about it. So you've got Meat Loaf at one end, and you might have Slayer or Napalm Death or something at the other end.
Two, promised to Q magazine the reunion of rock legends Meat Loaf and Jim Steinman.
Q is for people who haven't bought an album for 5 years, but they will buy the event album.
You know, Q magazine, who is the authoritative voice of the, you know, the mainstream rock audience, for them, that was a perfect story.
He's had to wait 12 and a half hours for Jim Steinman to arrive for the Q interview, but when he did finally arrive, it was pretty strong.
Exclusive number three.
Vox is aiming itself at Texas home care land.
For Vox, an LA junket on the making of the video.
Probably had a similar budget to Four Weddings and a Funeral, although it was only like a 4-day shoot. Meat Loaf was just this consummate professional sitting there in this hideous makeup, leather jacket, sort of all wrapped up in shawls and things like that. And it was about 90 degrees, typical kind of Hollywood mid-spring kind of day. And he was just waiting patiently to be asked to come back and act like a raving sort of runaway honey monster again.
And true to the broad spectrum demographic, last but not least...
We've got the Sunday magazine, News of the World, which is all set to go the Sunday before release.
Get the cover on that.
Which is guaranteed.
As long as Virgin guaranteed to stifle any other Meat Loaf stories on that Sunday.
I think that was what was clever about the campaign. They didn't go for the London trendy set, because they knew that they'd be scorned by them anyway. They didn't try and get a late show special on Meat Loaf. He doesn't want to be hip. I mean, hip. When he says the word hip, he sort of spits out, you know. He just simply wants to appeal to everybody.
From specialist music mag to a 4 million mass circulation Sunday, every demographic covered. No problem for Meat Loaf the actor, with a press persona for every occasion.
When I'm doing like a string of interviews, I try to make them all different.
The rock idol.
I really try to vary it.
The reformed drinker.
I try to make up different stories all the time.
The regular down-home guy.
I do, too.
The committed family man.
Unlike some artists who you read their interview and then they go, oh, here's another one. What are we said in this one? It's exactly the same thing.
But Meat Loaf's not averse to some well-rehearsed lines.
Meat Loaf is one of his acting jobs. It happens to be his main acting job, and it spills over into his real life.
What's your name? Your real name?
You know, no one's asked me that question before. What's my real name?
Yeah.
We know.
Security. Let's see. Let's think of a good one. Lamar Hunt.
Meat Loaf's a marketing person's dream. His name alone is a marketing tool, giving rise to endless, sometimes painful, headlines and copy.
Meat, what exactly do people call you?
But always reinforcing that crucial brand name.
Meat,
Meat Loaf.
No, not the dish, the singer.
He was a phenomenon as a live performer.
He's one of the rock icons of the 70s.
Now Meat is back,
gaining renewed respect in the 90s.
The sequel, which was just released, debuted at number 3 on the Billboard charts.
Divergence Absolute Relief and Joy debuted at number 1 in the UK.
Ladies and gentlemen, here he is.
Hi, I'm Paul Conroy. I'm head of Virgin Records. I'm here with Meat Loaf. And Meat Loaf, I would like to present to you, for sales of 1 million copies in the first 12 weeks, million units in the UK.
Only 1 million.
This is the magic of the music business, turning plastic to silver, silver to gold, and gold to platinum.
When we hit the street with the first single, we had enormous positive response to it. We were nearly 1 million albums on the initial shipments, and very rapidly went to 2 million, and rapidly after that went to 3 million.
That's great.
The Alchemists congratulate themselves.
He is a wonderful artist in the complete sense.
I love Al Teller.
Straight to me.
He was wonderful.
He's a great... He's one of the best.
That's great.
Millions changing hands in the music business economy is fickle. 200 new releases each week in the UK alone vie for the leisure pound. Staying at number one means having to outsell the competition week after week, and popular taste is nothing if not ephemeral. Making music is only a small part of an industrial process of production and consumption, as the star soon learns.
Today was not exactly the most unstressful day I've had in my life. Let me tell you what I bring to the company. I bring to the party a work ethic that is very strong. Lack of sleep and things like that.
And a mastery of meet and greet.
How you doing? I'm not worthy.
The charts do more than chart success, they breed success, becoming a marketing tool in their own right. Chart position encourages airplay, airplay sales, sales enhance chart position, guaranteeing more airplay, sales, and so on. And out on the road.
Right now, I'm just kind of like focused on this next 160 shows.
Best sales rep of all.
I'm going to walk on stage and I'm going to open with the number one single. And anybody that's late, it serves them right.
They'll just have to go out and buy their own copy, won't they? And keep those sales. By this process, Meat Loaf fought off the competition for an astonishing 8 weeks, threatening to become the mythic Christmas number one. It's more than a sentimental honor. The giving season is a sales bonanza for the music biz, shifting 40% of all annual units. Amongst the traditional fare, the big names and the compilation albums, other blasts from the past, whose first hit was coincidentally also 16 years ago, are preparing their challenge. If a gap can be found in the Christmas market, who better to plug it than that legendary industry grafter, the plugger?
Hard hats, soft hats, cowboy hats.
It is up to us to get the record exposed. And in most cases, that is what will sell records.
Look at these.
What are we going to say?
I think we should say that we're not the village people. That's a huge amount of pressure.
Because after all, we're not.
Oh, it's probably the hardest job on the planet. Ever since God invented this beautiful thing called the gramophone record, there are radio stations that won't play them. And long may that live. Because as long as they don't play them, I've got a job.
Richard, darling, do me up at the back, will you, please?
The desperate need for airplay can lead to desperate measures.
Looking a bit compromising over there, boys.
Industry scandals, payola, prostitutes and pushers surface periodically, but chaps and chains are today's tools of persuasion.
The thing is, I've got these ridiculous heels. I just can't walk on them.
Here we go, boys.
We should have a photo shoot with each one of us as a letter.
I'm not on it, mate.
Look at the bottom bit.
Oh, I mentioned my pirouette there.
Yeah. Oh, God, they're not easy.
Jock should be in
the
middle.
I'll probably do all this.
Yeah. How did you get to be the lead singer?
Talent.
The plugger's creed is simple. If they hear it, they might like it. If they like it, they might buy it. Hence, the task is clear. Influence the media, persuade the persuaders, press, radio, and TV.
I'm gonna give you some of that. We did a little thing.
I think it just comes naturally to it.
The star has a public persona, but the plugger's immediate audience is not the public. The targets for this teaser campaign are industry professionals, radio producers and DJs, whose individual decisions stand between a product's release and its potential mass consumer audience.
And it's a selling job.
All right, bye. We're not village people.
Definitely not the village people.
But we're here to see Pat Sharp.
We take my one record.
You got the CDs?
And they've got their 300 record from the rest of the industry.
Who's got the CDs?
Anybody who's a radio producer, a TV producer, will take all the big stars first. And our job really is to get them to notice ours that's in the residue.
Well, there's a single.
Well, thank you. Yeah.
Label profit and listening pleasure, the record company and broadcasting symbiosis. A delicate balance between servicing and soliciting, a cozy collusion.
Well, I hope you're all very happy together.
Thank you, dear.
Do you think you're more remarkable?
Now, do you think this person's...
Do you think he's still alive?
Every DJ and producer alive will be force-fed village people through their pigeonholes.
Chris Tarrant, obviously we want him to play.
Okay, chaps, let's go and do what we've got.
The campaign seems to be going according to plan. Advance promises of airplay are mounting, and the world seems suddenly awash with YMCA CDs.
Call me at Arista and I'll send you the album.
Can you do me a favour? Can you bike a YMCA CD to Radio 1?
Nigel Hall at Good Morning.
Ozone or something.
Live and kicking. Dance Energy.
Dance Energy.
Now they must lunch Breakfast TV.
Tell him we're coming to get him to take him out for some lunch.
Or schmoozing, as it's otherwise known.
If you're on this dress like this every day for a month,
we'll pretend that we know you really well.
Yes.
Schmoozing slipped into horse trading.
What's the possibility of them coming on the programme?
They're very good.
And what are the shows they're going to do while they're here?
Everything.
The deal, a personal appearance. Good Morning wants a scoop.
To have them on the couch before the other shows would be really good.
If we can arrange it so they can travel, then we can look at that as well.
But once the viewers have seen them, then you kind of lost part of that kind of watchability. Do you know what I mean? So to have them first would be really kind of something, and we'd do something kind of rather special for you. I mean, we could do a Village People Morning for you, which I think would work really well.
Leave it with us, we'll see what we can do.
Yeah.
TV's appetite for images demands a constant supply of personalities. Village People's diary is filling up.
Oh, good, how are you?
18 TV spots already to be juggled during one UK visit.
This is what we do.
Sandwiched between Barry Manilow and his 17.
Are they going to be reliable? Because last time I was supposed to do a shoot with the Village People, they cancelled it with 10 minutes to go.
For promotion, there's no substitute for the real thing, the artist.
We'll do it, yeah, don't worry.
Okay, fine.
10 minutes notice.
Okay, are you walking back?
What, like this, yeah. A shepherd's bush?
£5 if you want them, and £5 if you don't.
As pop shopping days to Christmas dwindle, Arista's pluggers have done all they can. Recommended by retail, industry campaign of the week, a creditable UK chart debut, but a scheduling snag. The band can't make the UK gigs. All those personal appearances and photo opportunities, so crucial to chart position, lost. So, who's still at number one? The artist who's happily promoted himself in several countries, Mr. Meet and Greet himself.
Hi, Tommy. Right. So we've got the interview tomorrow. We've got Simon Bates' interview coming up. Ben's in New York, but when's he coming back?
He's here straight from the taping of the David Letterman show. Please welcome, give it up for Meat Loaf.
Because we're straight from there off to Australia.
I mean, there are plenty of occasions when he was on the other side of the world and we needed him to talk to a journalist in the UK. And, you know, just literally trying to do things by remote control.
Meat staggers obediently.
To the right.
Down to the right.
Yep. Here.
From New York press conference to London recording session.
Is that where the room we're in, or are we in this room?
That's the room we're in.
Oh, we're in
to TV interview.
But we're doing this little thing first.
Oh, okay.
Constantly in demand.
We really need him.
Well, I'm bad out of hell. I used to say I was a train. I was the engine, and I was pulling all the cars. On this one, there was this large steamship, and I was in this little rowboat being pulled along behind it. I mean, we've done like about 14,000 interviews, and I've gone around the world.
You would just do anything you wanted to do. You would do anything.
I would do anything for love. And the problem was, next time I go around the world, I want to go west. I don't want to go east.
The indefatigable, globe-spanning Mr. Loaf has notched up worldwide sales of over 10 million. The long-term gamble has more than paid off. Why not one last flutter on the end-of-year charts?
I was one that had a few quid on.
Well, it wouldn't be Xmas without a tune from pop music's biggest tennis fan. Game, set and match, the Clipper 27.
Cliff Richard, who you might describe as a horse with very little form throughout the rest of the year, is usually an active contender at Christmas.
Alton and Kiki, number six, True Love.
She could describe them as a pair of old hacks that have been around as long as anybody can remember, a bit like Red Rum. Rod Stewart's had 100 quid on him, and he's not known to chuck his money away, but I think he's on a loser this time.
£1,000 win.
It's very difficult to say. I don't think we have horses like that.
The best looking lady in the charts, Dina's back at 8.
Well, 20-1, she represents a fair each way chance.
But there was a major threat from another portly artist.
Mr. Blucky, I mean, a 5-2 chance, but you'd have to describe him as the music business equivalent of Foyn Avon, who was the last 100-1 shot winner of the Grand National.
Mr. Blobby, I think, you know, a major artist for the future, really took it on strongly.
I can't for the life of me imagine who in their right mind would want to back Mr. Blobby, apart from Noel Edmonds, who's had a four-figure sum on the record himself to get to number one, so he's got a bit of a vested interest on it, making it.
The Sun were very, very keen to get a picture of Mr. Blobby and meet together, but unfortunately we could not schedule that. But I'll never
forget. A 16-year absence, a 4-year campaign finally took its toll. Was the old rocker to be dethroned by callow youth?
Here comes Babe.
Well, I think there's certainly a lot of excitement amongst those people who currently hold 8-1 vouchers about Take That and 33-1 vouchers about Mr. Blobby. I think they're probably quite desperate at the moment that no big star makes the ultimate career move and dies between now and Christmas, because that could still give someone the chance to nip in front of those two leading contenders.
So Meat Loaf and all the other stars were pipped to the post by a pink and yellow rubber puppet. The music biz has no prejudices where profit is concerned. While the Inkies may agonize over credibility, NME gave Meat Loaf a Brat Award for Worst Record and Video of the Year, his industry colleagues had no qualms about his commercial clout, voting him Best Male Rock Performer.
Probably what Meat Loaf offers is a very controlled version of the rock and roll myth, a very theatrical and actually quite safe, a theme park version, basically, of the rock and roll myth.
Welcome to the 36th Annual Grammy Awards. The recording industry presents its highest accolade to artists and musicians for outstanding achievement.
Yeah, enough respect to all the nominees, you know.
Hello.
Hello.
This is great. This is great. I don't even know what I'm supposed to do up here, but...
Anybody would like to ask me anything? Or would you just like to stand here to, you know, like Mike Taylor to...
Someone help me. Thank you. Thanks.
It actually doubles as a hearing aid. People today said to me, well, how do you feel about being at the Grammys? I said, well, there's a lot of celebrities here, and I get nervous around celebrities.
I
feel like I'm part of the club now.
Oh, it's wonderful. God has been so good to me. Thank you, Jesus.
And thank you, product managers, press officers, radio and TV promotions, A&R, and all the music biz backroom boys and girls who deserve and get their very own pat on the back.
One of the most hard-fought categories each year is that of Best Marketing Campaign.
For Best Read Biggest, you're unlikely to win without a massive chart hit to show for the fruits of your marketing labour.
This year, there were 21 entries, and our expert judging panel sat through 8 hours of presentation. 8 hours!
Top-selling artists will endure hours and hours of the agony and the ecstasy of awards ceremonies.
Meat, before you go, come over here. We have a very special award for you.
Well done to Meat Loaf, clearly, and well done to all the Virgin troops sitting
that
over there.
That, too, put Virgin at the top of the label charts. You win some and you lose some. When you win, you savour the moment, contemplating your response during that. So in response to radio and TV promotion, A-list airplay, heavy rotation video, fly posting, touring, chat shows, advertising, meet and greets, and all the other paraphernalia of record marketing, including awards ceremonies, have this year alone purchased worldwide $35 billion worth of artists' products. including millions of Meatloaf's own, to which the Biz says,
thank you.
Yes.
Hello.
Hello. Hey.
Can I ask a question? It's John Boy from the Daily Star. Are you a bit disappointed that after going to spokes number one in the singles and albums chart, selling a lot of units, that you haven't won Walk Tonight?
No, why should I be disappointed?
Well, wouldn't you like to be gratified by, you know, what you've done?
No, you've got to understand something, and I'm going to explain something to you. Whether I win an award or whether I don't, what I do is a luxury. What I do is a privilege, and it is an honor. What it means when you get to that kind of position is that the people have brought you into their homes, and they brought you into their hearts. I've become possessed by God and by good, and I go for it and give it everything I got.
Wait, I'm still talking, guys. I'll come to you in a second.
The awards thing is really a pain. I got news for you. It's first time I've ever been nominated, first time I ever won a Grammy. So, you know, it's fine. I'm glad we get nominated. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, everyone. Thank you.
Just the actual fact of being there and going, you know, and going, hi, how are you?
An insecure industry hopes annually for a rare hit like Meatloaf to finance its more frequent misses.
All right, kids.
It was absurd when the original came out in 1977, but at the height of punk over here, you know, it was a grand rock opera, totally over the top, totally camp, outlandishly extravagant, absolutely no market for it. And it sold 23 million copies or something like that, and it's in the Guinness Book of Records. But then 16 years later, was 1993 the right time to bring out another Bat Out of Hell album? Well, there's never going to be a right time.
What he cost us? A lot of money. A lot of money to record, to keep him going from the years from 89 onwards. And what he's made us?
And I would suspect that when the dust settles on this particular album, it will end up being one of the biggest selling albums in the history of MCA Records.
Millions? Several
millions, then. Money.
Well, give it just
a second. I mean, as I haven't heard the whole record, what is it you won't do for them?
But you won't do that.
What? You're not going to ask me that. Are you going to ask me what is that?
Well, if you listen to the lyrics, it goes,
Bob. I missed.
Bob.
Sorry.
All right, now listen to this. What are the lyrics? I feel like I'm on stage.
I would do anything for love. I'd run right into hell and back.
I'd do anything for love and I'd lie to you, and that's a fact.
But I'll never forget
the way you feel right now.
The way you feel right now, no way.
No way.
I'll never forget myself if we don't go all the way tonight. Beep.
Mark, just before you go, what is it that he won't do for love? Don't want to know, okay. Rimming, apparently. Well, there we are.
And finally, of course, the key one, well, you'll sooner or later you'll be screwing around.
Sooner or later you'll be screwing around.
No, I won't. You know.